Our next speaker has been named one of the most influential people in the world by a reader's poll in Time magazine. The French magazine Terra Echo chose him as one of the 100 green persons that will change the world. I don't know if the Incredible Hulk was on that list or not. He is the founder of the Dutch architectural firm called Water Studio. Please welcome Koen Oldhuis.
Good afternoon. A few months ago, I was in Spain, and I had to give a lecture for 500 architects, and that's always really a difficult audience. And while I was talking, I looked into the audience, and I only saw black suits. So it was just as being at a funeral. So I came home, and I have this little son, he's called Max, and he's 6 years old, and I told him the story, and I asked him, what do you think, why do architects wear black? And he said, Daddy, it's so obvious, because you all draw with a sketch with black pants, and you don't want to have any stains on your suit. So that's a good solution. And then he asked me a question. He said, Daddy, what's the use of an architect? So I had to think about that. And today I want to show you a blueprint for a better city, but because I think that architects should be working on improvement of cities. Architecture is quite conservative. Although we build these beautiful shapes and we use all these new kind of materials, it's still static components in a dynamic world. So that means when we put something on one spot, it has to stay there for a very long time. But the problem is that during time, demands change. So if you look in almost every city, you see buildings that are vacant, or even buildings that are not finished. I come a lot in, many times in Dubai. Dubai is hit by financial crisis quite heavily. And you see all these towers, just concrete shells, nothing with it, and just putting money in it and not being used anymore. So I think that we should look differently against our cities. Our cities are dynamic because society is dynamic. And we have all these urban impulses that have an effect on how we want to use our cities. Social changes. 20 years ago, 40 years ago, people lived completely different. Climate change, geographical changes, political changes, they all have effect on how we want to use our cities. So I think that if you build a building, it has to stay there for 50 years. But if you don't want to use it anymore, you can do two things. You can demolish it, or you have to leave it on the location. So that doesn't make sense. So I think that we have to find a way to make our cities more fast, because cities today are too slow and too static. And the way to do that, to make cities more fast, is to start building for change. In an idle city, I think buildings should appear as fast as demands change. So this is a little movie of a city. It's like 12 years. And if it could have been in 2 years, that would be fantastic. It's all about response time. So if you have a question, are you thirsty? Then it takes you 30 seconds to go and take some water and drink something. If you need some clothes, it's only half a day and I can go to the shop and take some clothes. Or if I want a car, it takes me a month and I have a complete new car. But the problem is with a building is it takes so much longer. From the first moment that I want to build a building in the center of a city, of course, maybe in New York or London, I first have to find a building, demolish it, get a license to build something upon it, find an architect, find a constructor. So it takes so much time. So at the moment that I've built that building, if I finish it, then the question has already changed. So what we should do is we should shorten response time. And for that, we don't have to find new technology, because technology is already existing. The only thing we have to do, we have to change two perceptions, change two mindsets. And the first one is that there is no space in cities, that the cities are full. I don't think that cities are full. We just have to find new space. And it happened before. 100 years ago, we had Mr. Otis. Mr. Otis was the inventor of the elevator. And before that, people couldn't walk up more than 3 stories. So the city was quite flat. And he found a solution to use space above the city. Because with the elevator, you could go up 20, 30, 40 stories. And we have to do exactly the same. Look in our cities and see if we can find new space. Looking at Hong Kong, Shanghai, Sydney, all cities would have water enough, rivers, sea, canals, lakes. And we should start using that water. If you look at buildings, normal buildings, we have different kind of foundations. In a normal country, not my country, because that's very soft, but in a normal country, you just make a sleeve in the ground, pour some concrete in it, and put a house on top of it. And if you have a very soft soil, so as we have in Holland, you put some stilts in the ground, and you can put exactly the same house on top of it. Well, we now deliver a new kind of foundation, and it's a floating foundation. And the floating foundation can, again, bury exactly the same house. We make it from concrete. Concrete boxes, and we make them factories. We place the house on top of it. We make it, bring it on the water, and we tow it over the rivers to the final location. And if we want to go bigger, we can make foundations of concrete and foam up to 1,000 by 1,000 feet, with streets on top of it, houses on top of it, trees on top of it. So real urban components with which you can make a complete city. And the beauty about these elements, they can go up and down with the water. So the first thing we have to change is going from land to water. The second one is that buildings are static. We have to make them dynamic. And maybe you've already recognized this image. It's an image of the Burning Man Festival in Nevada. And what I like about this is each year, the 100,000 campers come together. And in 2 weeks, they completely build the city, use the city, and afterwards, they take everything away, and it's back to normal. So if you can do that, then we can also do that with normal cities. We only have to change our perception. And we already did that with another product. Maybe you all have a smartphone, and probably look all the same, but they are not the same. Because you have personalized your own iPhone. You put on your own apps, your own things. You are the city planner of your own smartphone. Well, I think we should look upon cities exactly the same. We should start having floating city apps, which are floating housing, floating energy, floating agriculture, floating islands, and bring them to the city at the moment that you need it. So we go from project to product. And that changes everything, because then you have a city which is the hardware and the floating functions that are the software. If you do that, then we can come into a new kind of urbanism, which you call consumption urbanism. And consumption urbanism treats urban components as products. And it gives a new kind of advantages. And I will just go through some projects we do in Holland and in other places in the world to show you what it can do. This is a project in the center of Holland, and it's called The Citadel. It's a floating apartment building, and there are 90 apartments in it. And it's in a zone in which there is a lot of greenhouses. Holland, maybe as you know, is under sea level, so all the greenhouses you see are also on the sea level. So we have to pump away a lot of water to make the country dry. If you stop pumping, then water will come back immediately. And this polder, it works like a sponge. So each drop of water that falls in it can be absorbed by the ground, and when it's dry, it gives water back. But what we did in Holland, we start building greenhouses in it, and we start building cities in it. So now in this moment, where we have the effects of climate change, we have more water, more rain, heavier rain, it's not easy to bring the water back to the sea. So we have to find a new solution. We have to make storage areas, water storage areas. That means we have to take away a part of the greenhouses and give it back to the water. And then when there's a lot of rain, you can pump all the water back to that zone. That costs a lot of money. You have to take the farmers out. But we have to find a solution because we can build on top of that water. Well, here you can see the area. It's 2.5 kilometers long and a few hundred meters wide. And we built 1,200 houses in it. And 600 of these houses will be floating houses. Some on small islands, some houses in a row, and of course the apartment building here in the center. So when there's a lot of rain, we pump the water into this area, and this complete building will lift up 30 centimeters. Here you see the entrance to the car park, because we have a car park underneath the building. And it's floating, of course, so it can go up too. And I think this is the new way, this is an advantage that you don't have to, on land. Another project we're doing is the floating mosque. We were asked for Dubai to come up with a floating mosque. And it was not because they liked water so much, but if they had to do it on land, or on artificial land, by landfill, then it would cost too much space. And we invented this mosque, but we wanted to do something more. We wanted to use the water to cool down the building. So we designed a building in which the walls are 1 meter thick. And we pump the water through the floors, through the walls, over the roof, through the columns, back to the sea. And by that we can bring down the temperature from 50 degrees back to 30 degrees Celsius. This is a huge energy saver. And if you would walk through this mosque, you would see the five columns of faith. And you see all the water going through back to the sea. So it's an open system. Something you can't do on land and you can't do on water. Sustainability. Another project, this is one of my favorites, is the sea tree. The sea tree is a building only for animals and for fishes. So it's a 30 meter high building. And it's a concrete. And we give the ability to the nature to let it grow over there. And what you see in many cities is that because of urbanization, the pressure on green zones is quite big. And so they need a little bit more ecology support. And this one, it's floating. And it's using exactly the same technology as the oil companies use for storage for instance, Norway. So what we want to show is that the technology of the oil companies can also provide some very good and very pleasant solutions for cities. Because if you bring it into a city, you will see that birds and bees, they don't stay at that location. They really go like 2 kilometers, 5 kilometers around this space. And if you don't have one sea tree, but you have, for instance, 10 or 15 of these sea trees, you really can make a difference. Another thing is scarless developments. We've been asked by the government of the Maldives to come up with a solution to provide more tourism. They have 1,200 islands, small islands, and 900 of them are under the sea level. Only 200 have land mass. So if they want to make a new island for hotels, they have to bring a lot of sand into these lagoons. And that will totally destroy underwater life. And the beauty is what we can do. We can bring complete floating resorts, and those resorts, they just hover on top of the water. So if you take them away after 150 years or 200 years, it doesn't leave any scars. And during lifespan, we want to be as carbon neutral as possible using floating energy, water cooling. So no footprint during lifespan and no footprint after lifespan. Another project we're doing in the same area, also near Malé, the capital city of the Maldives, are 43 floating private islands. And the beauty of these islands is that you can just buy your own island. You can shape your own island. So you come to design, you ask, oh, I want to have a shape like a country or like the face of my wife. And, and imagine you sitting on this island. You see the little houses there? That's the guest house. And with this island, we also deliver very small submarines. So all your friends are already sitting in the guest house, and then with one button, the floor opens, and the submarine comes up. And the man of the house opens and it's in the house. This all can all be done there. Another project in the same area, because we have five projects over there, is a floating hotel. The Maldives want to be in the center of discussion for climate change, renewable energy. But they don't have space for a big hotel. So we're now designing and developing a Green Star. And the Green Star is a hotel of 1,250 feet diameter, and it's built up of five concrete cruise ships connected to one concrete ring. But in fact, we don't build five of these ships, we build six. So after 5 years or 6 years, when you have to start refurnishing this kind of buildings, you can just come on with a new leg, pull one leg off, and plug the other leg in. So it's a plug-and-play system, completely new in hotel business. If you go any further and you think about the future, then I think that we will go to cities that use water much more. And those cities will grow in a very flexible way, using these urban components. And if I think about these cities, it would look a bit like Venice. All these floating things connect to each other, and all the water routes in between. And I think the beauty about this is that after 20 years or 30 years, when you think that the functions are not on the right location, you can just move them around. Same like a shuffle puzzle. You just bring one piece to another piece. And this it sounds a little strange, but it's already happening. We already have these floating towers in Holland that are produced in one city, brought over the water to another location. So it's nothing new. It's something that is really existing. If you think a little bit bigger, then this also can be a solution for the Olympic Games. How stupid is it that each 4 years we build a complete new city with stadiums, with hotel facilities, all the things, and then it's only been used for 2 weeks? Yeah, if you're lucky, you can use it for 4 weeks for the Paralympics too, but it is a very short period. So I think that would be a solution to build floating stadiums and bring them from London to Rio to the other cities, or even use them for the World Soccer Games. And the beauty is that also other countries are thinking of the same thing. This is a floating harbor, which we first designed for Dubai. And when I designed it, I had to go to the developer, and I had to present my ideas, and it was really big. It's like 300 meters, so it's 1,000 feet by 1,000 feet by 1,000 feet. And I went in, and after 10 minutes, I could go back to Holland, because the first thing he said was be larger. So we had to scale it up to, it was almost 2,000 by 2,000 by 2,000 feet. So I was really thinking, oh, how can I tell this to my engineers? But the engineer said, oh, that's perfect, because the bigger, the larger the building gets, the more stable it gets. You see here, there's a little harbor that's protected for the taxi boats. And inside, there's also a hotel and there's some facilities. And these kind of buildings can go from one city to the other city, flexible harbors. This sounds very nice, but it's still only for the rich. And when I started this story, I said I wanted to improve cities. So if you really want to improve cities, you have to see what the big problems are. And the big problems are not in the major Western cities. They are in developing countries. In the next 20 years, you will see that in developing countries, we get all the pressure on these slums. Slums will grow rapidly. And I think that we have the hope to use all the technology from the Maldives and from the Netherlands to help these slums. So wet slums, slums that are next to the water, are particularly vulnerable for the effects of climate change. So people want to stay much away from the water, but on the edge from water and land, that's the only place they can build. So what we started to do, together with IHG UNESCO, is we started to identify wet slums. And we went to the cities and asked for maps, but there are no maps of slums. So we had to draw each map by hand, each house drawn in, and we had a whole team who helped us for that. And when we did that, we could start analyzing those slums. So we have this program in which we can see what is the potential to use city apps in such a slum. And in some places, people pay, for instance, 40% of the income to clean water, or they have no access to clean sanitation. So by analyzing all the slums, you can see exactly what the needs are. We did it for 20 slums worldwide. And the next step is then, how can we help the slums? Should we donate money to that places? Now, we don't think so. We should have to make a business case of it. So we think that we can do it by leasing out products. We think that we can build the city apps in the Western world. We can tow them over to these locations. And if there's a need for food, water, energy, you can bring the city apps to that place. And it's a dynamic process. Because while you're upgrading such a slum, where the slums are growing, you can bring new products in and take other products out. So it's really a flexible process. Those slums will grow over water. So before, water was something to be afraid of. By having floating developments, it can be something that can be as useful for your slum. And we get a question, is it not dangerous to build on water? Well, we think that it's safer for the slum to be on top of the water than to next to the water. If you think about tsunamis, they are on the open water, it's just a very small wave. It's only built up when it's on land. Or think about earthquakes. If you're underwater, the water is a perfect shock absorber. Hurricanes, if you have these kind of buildings and the wind is pulling on the building, that can absorb a little bit of the energy. Floating sanitation. A lot of the black water comes immediately in those canals. So if we can make these filters, then we can do something about the quality of the water. Floating shelter. Quickly make the city bigger. Floating energy. The same I was talking about when we're using the projects in the Maldives, we can now use for these energy production in the slums itself. and even floating agriculture.